And welcome back to this week's Magic video. As you can see, we're doing a top 10 list today. I don't do as many top lists as I used to. I used to do top 5s, but that was just really what wasn't doing overly that great for the videos. I still have them on. I mean, I still do the top lists. It's just I don't do top 5s anymore. I kind of went away from that. But this week, I figured, you know, with everything going on, well, not everything going on, there's a lot of things, weighing between sets for spoilers, having to do a Magic video every week, I figured, why not do some top lists? I'm going to start this week off with the top 10 white-blue Azorius colors. I'm going to do one for all the guild colors, one for all the tri-colors. I'll do a list for all of them at some point. I don't know, it might not be every week because our stuff happens, but I will do that. But anyway, yeah. Now, when judging the criteria for this, it was whether I played with them or not was a big issue. If I played with them, it definitely helped in the process, if I had the card or not. But also, what I do know about the card, how I basically just see the card overall, I know, not even from lore, just, you know, functioning perspective. I also don't have visuals. Sorry. It's just the way I kind of run sometimes. Just, again, because I don't have all the cards. In fact, how many of these cards do I actually own? I own, actually, to be fair, I own about half the cards on this list. And there's a fly here. One second, if I can get the fly. Let's see. Oh, no. Just one of those things, the cat box, you know, it doesn't get empty sometimes and flies happen. But yeah, no, I actually do own about half the cards on this list. I just, because I own half of them, I mean, I could have literally printed every card out on the sheet, but that would have been just silly. Now, that being said, I have some plans for other videos down the road, and if I can work some things out, I will print out the cards for those. Because it will be one of those it'll be a video, a special video, for ideas I have. I'll get to that at another point in time, but right now we're talking this. So anyway, and the number 10 spot, I put Godhead of Awe. Godhead of Awe is a Eventide, I believe is an Eventide card. Yeah, it's an Eventide card. Not a Shadow War, it's an Eventide. Yeah, one second. I'm going to double check on that. Get that one off the screen there. And here we go. Godhead of Awe. I believe that was a Eventide, right? Godhead of Awe. Let's see. Godhead of Awe. Let's see now. No, I was wrong. It was Shadowmoor. Oh, well. But no, Godhead of Awe. It cost 5 mana to play. It was a 4/4 flyer that turned everything else into a 1/1. Now, it's a guy who has a white-blue deck, has a lot of fun with the white-blue deck. Let's put it this way. When you put just one Cumberstone on the field, which gives all your opponent's creatures -1/-0, and you turn all his creatures into a 1/1, regardless of their abilities, you've now completely depowered his or her entire field. That is some of the funnest crap I run 4 Cumberstones in that deck, by the way. So, and plus a bunch of other stuff. So I'm going to stall, Cumberstone. I'm now giving your entire field a -4/-0. What's that? You've got 5/5, 6/6, and 7/7s. They can still do damage? Godhead of Awe. Not anymore, bitch. and I don't mean that towards any women. I just mean that in general. But Godhead of Awe. And then you still have a 4/4 flyer that you can swing in and do stuff with. You put Steel of the Godhead, which when I was going down the list, I actually had to go down the list on a Star City of all the white blue cards, but here that was did make the list. But then because I had over 10, so I had to slim it down. Put that on. You turn into a 6/6 with again unblockable and lifelink. You now have a 6/6 slot of unblockable flying lifelinker. And see, like, okay, even if you could do something, I'm gaining 6 life and doing 6 damage. What you gonna do? So, God of Awe is a personal favorite. Next, we have number 9, Skymark Rock, an uncommon bird from, I believe, yeah, it was definitely Ravnica, that one, was it? No, that was Dragon's Mace. I actually do remember, I think that one was Dragon's Mace. Again, Skymark, whoop, Rock. There we go. Skymark Rock. Not Mark, but, oh, it was this was, by the way. I believe that was Dragon's Maze? Yes? No, it was Return of Ravnica. I was right the first time. I will get one of these right. But no, Skymark Rock is a 2/3, 4/4, 2/4 mana, 1 blue, 1 white, 2 generic, flying bird. Seems basic enough, but whenever it attacks, a defending player returns a creature with 2 or less toughness to their hand. Now, when they have only chump blockers on the field, that's a big ability to use. It's just a generally useful card. It's 3 mana for 4. You can get it out easy. If you got a little bit of mana, you can get it on turn 3, swing in, and then start popping their stuff. It's not going to pop everything, but it's still good. Should also note that there are a lot of the main cards in this. There was a lot of good cards I put on here. Like, I would have put maybe Glass Duck, Dust Hulk on the battle in this list, but it's dependent solely on an artifact deck, which is something you need to build around. Some of these cards are build around cards, but they're not limited to literally one card type. Next on the list is Thistledown Liege. Thistledown Liege is a, I believe, that one was Shadowmoor. I know that one because they kept the avatars with the lieges. And it was Thistledown Liege. There we go. Just so I can have reference. Yeah, that was still Shadowmoor. And it was 4 with 3 white or blue hybrid mana and then 1. It was a 1/3 wood flesh. Now, it was definitely the weakest in terms of power among the lieges, and it could easily be killed if you were actually attacked with it. But let's be clear, you have a liege this weak, you don't attack with it, you just pop it down maybe as a combat trick, which for 4 mana isn't that terrible, all things considered. And then, you know, pump your entire field and just continue doing that. More than likely, most of the lieges will probably end up making my top 10 lists. But there are a lot of good cards out there. Any of the lieges are just solid cards, too, because they're just powering up your entire field. And if you're running multiples, then God bless you, you're completely haxing your field up. But it's a solid card. It doesn't do anything overly special other than pump up the field. So it was higher on the low end of the scale. Then we have... Okay, now, I didn't write his full name down. I really should have. Let's see now. Dex. Whoop. Daxos, not that one, damn it. Okay, there we go. Daxos of Metalus. This was a, was it 3? 1 second. Daxos of Metalus, and I don't want that, I just want the card. Well, how many mana was it? Okay, it was only 3 mana. It was a 2/2 legendary human soldier, 1 blue, 1 white, 1 generic. When it could not be blocked by creatures of power 3 or greater, which means if you gave this thing any sort of pump or first strike, there was no way it was being destroyed in battle. It's more or less completely unstoppable. Now, this is one of the cards I never did play with. I played with the first 3. I never played with Daxos. But this card is actually ridiculous, because if it ever dealt damage to a player, and again, give it first strike, or give it haste, or give it any sort of power-up, or give it flying, for God's sake. If you give it flying, you're pretty much not being touched on the ground or the sky. You need to be killed by a sorcery, or instant, or enchantment, or artifact, if there was one available. But when it deals combat damage, opponent exiled the top card of their library, and you gained life based on that card's converted mana cost, and until the end of that turn, you could cast that card and spend your mana as if the card's color were that card, if your mana was that card's color. So it didn't matter what the color of the card was, you could cast it regardless. Now, I know for a fact this card saw play. This card was dangerous. It wasn't like Snapcaster Mage dangerous, which I actually got a Snapcaster Mage at one point, and I traded it in, I think, for something I thought was more useful. Because, frankly, I'll be honest, because I'm not a competitive player, I don't see the appeal of some of these competitive cards. Like, I saw, don't get me wrong, I didn't see the appeal of Snapcaster Mage, just not in the same sense that all these tournament players were able to pull off. It's not that I am an idiot player, it's just I don't see it. But this guy, I know this guy saw a play. I know this guy did some work. I know this guy can do work. Again, you just pump him up a little bit. He can't be blocked unless you're going to chump block him with a bunch of stuff. And if you give him first strike, double strike, trample, whatever, you're still hitting them. You're still doing the damage. So it's a very basic, it's a simple card in many ways, but it's also a very complex card. And if you have multiple, it's a legendary creature, so you can't have more unless you're using Mirror Gallery shenanigans, which the fun of Mirror Gallery. It's a power play card. It really is. Number 6, Sphinx's Revelation. Oh yeah, I'm rolling it. Like I said, I can recognize a card when it's good. I just don't apparently recognize how good it is. Now, I've never played with Sphinx's Revelation myself, but let's be clear. I believe it's two white, one blue, and X. In fact, let me double check on that real quick. I think that's the case. Now, I do know for a fact this one was Return for Ravnica. The other one was Theros. Sphinx's Revelation. And yes, no, it was, yeah, it was two blue. Okay, it was two blue, one white, and X. You gain life, X life, and draw X cards. Obviously, it's a mid to late game when you've actually got mana to play it, but even if you had, I don't know, 8 mana on the field, or even just 7 mana on the field, you're getting paying 4 with X. You're getting 4 life, which is alright, but you're drawing 4 cards. It's the draw that's the big factor of Sphinx's Revelation. Then you have things that maybe react to card drawing effects, then shenanigans can just ensue. It's like, don't say that word again. What word? You know what I am. What was that place we went to? What, shenanigans? I hate you. Super Troopers there for you folks. But overall, I mean, yeah, it's again another just really solid card. But again, it's the advantage it gives you over your opponent, which is why it makes it higher on the list than some of the other things. With like Daxos, it can easily be destroyed. The only way you're getting rid of this card is if you counter it. And even then, if they have a counter spell in play or something to counter that, then it's not going to do anything. So yeah, number 5 is Sphinx's Revelation. Top 5s. Now, number 5 is Noyan Dar Roll Shaper. Now, I want to make sure I got his stats right, because I didn't write down his stats, but Noyan Dar, for those of you who don't know about Noyan Dar, showed up in Battle for Zendikar. Now, he was a 4/4 Merfolk ally. Cost 5, 3 generic, 2, 1 white, 1 blue. And whenever you cast an instance or sorcery spell, and this is where I made the comment that build around me cards, but with less hassle. This is a build around me card to a degree. It's a legendary creature, but you use both instants and sorceries, which a lot of decks can run plenty of. Whereas artifacts is a one niche market, even though you can have artifact creatures. You put +1/+1 counters on a target land, and that land turns into a creature. That's, you know, a 0/0 land creature, but you've put the +1/+1 counters on it, 3 of them, so you're automatically getting a 3/3 creature. Now, that sounds okay, and I believe it gets haste. Does it get haste? Sorry, one second, I gotta double check on that. Did it get haste? Yeah, it does get haste, which is rare for blue and white to do. Blue, almost, I can't even think anytime off the top of my head. Let me know if you can even think of a blue card that gives haste. White is iffy, usually has to be paired with another color, usually red, if I were to throw one out there. And blue can have haste if I think paired with blue as well, red as well. Red's definitely the haste color. But the reason this card is so freaking dangerous, and let's say you max out all your lands, first off, with +1. So they're all land creatures and stuff. It's like, woo! You can continue to play instants and sorceries, first off, and continue to stack the +1/+1 counters onto those creatures, making them bigger. But that's not the real scary thing. The real scary thing is this, is that with instants and sorceries, if you're running like just a bunch of unsummons, or just like 1 to 2 costing instants or sorceries, you could play anywhere from 3 to 4, and did I just want to double check if this untapped them at all, because I don't remember it. If you do lands, okay, it doesn't untap them, so there is that, but there's plenty of things to get around that. You can play anywhere from like 2 to 3 to 4 enchantments or sorceries in a turn if they're low costing, and then you suddenly make an army of land creatures. Especially if you got things that are just producing mana too. So like, okay, I'm going to produce mana with my cards, tap those, don't have to tap my lands. I'm going to play like 3 sorceries, which is possible. It's doable depending on what kind of deck you're playing. If you're running like a Bant deck with, what was it? Oh, it's not Flux Mage. The Evolve card Elf that when you put, whenever, for every +1/+1 counter, you can tap it for green. then you get that many green. If you can do something like that, like Land of War Elves and something, combinations like that, and then you've like played 3 to 4 sorceries, 2 to 3 sorceries, you immediately have an army of creatures that can just swing in for 3. So the card advantage when you build around this card properly is immense. Now, obviously, you don't play more than maybe 2, maybe 3 copies. But 2, I think, would be the best. You don't normally run too many legendary creatures of the same card because they cancel each other out. Number 3 on this list is Geist of St. Trav. This card I have played with before. This card is powerful. This card is 3 mana for a 2/2 with Hexproof, back when they basically retconned Shroud and made it a Hexproof. And honestly, I'm just an upgraded version of Hexproof, or Shroud, sorry. And, you know, it did work. It did. You could equip it. You could give it flying. So you and the angel that comes out are flying. You could do a lot of things. It was just a very versatile card. And, sorry, I thought I heard something. And it just worked. There was many things. I know people did, like, you couldn't do Restoration Angel tactics with it because it was when it was attacking. Unless you were able to give yourself another combat step. There's also Parallel Lies, which came out in that set as well. So you could have 2 angels come out in the field and attack. I mean, it was, and then maybe equipped like a Silver Moon Spear onto that. So now you have 4 angels, or no, you have 2 angels. Yeah, 2 angels come out because you're attacking with the spear, and with St. Trav. Then Parallel Lies, that 4 angels came out. That's just hilarious in my mind. So yeah, I mean, it made number 2 because it's easy to play, it's easy to use, it's easy to pump. So it's just one of the most versatile blue-white cards in my mind. Remaining 2. Render Silence. This came out, I believe, in Return to Ravnica. Let me double check on that one real quick. If it wasn't, it was definitely one of the Render Silent. It was definitely one of the Ravnicas. No, it was Dragon's Maze. That's what you get. But Render Silence. You counter target spell, and your opponent can't play spells for the remainder of the turn. It's essentially saying, I counter the one thing you're going to do this turn. I'm going to counter the very first thing you do this turn, and I'm going to end your turn. That's it. That's basically what it's saying. I mean, the best case scenario for anyone who gets caught by this is hopefully you have something else on the field. But if this is early in the game, or if you top deck something and you need it, you're screwed. This thing is absurdly powerful. It only costs 2 blue and 1 white. It's only 3 mana. If you're in blue and white, you're going to play this card. This is a dangerous card, especially if you're running multiples. Oh my god, if you're running multiples, which if you had this, I would imagine you're probably playing multiples. It's unreasonably mean. Again, the only way you can avoid real damage is if you already have some stuff on the field. But if you don't have anything else on the field, or if you only got 1 or 2 things on the field and you're behind, you've got a problem with this. This card will shut you down. So, I mean, just on its pure stopping power alone, I put Render Silence at number 1, or number 2. But my number 1 card is from the original Dissension, the original Ravnica block, and I want to get his name right, Grand Arbiter Augustine IV. That is right, the original head of the Azorius from the original Ravnica. 2/3, 2, 1 white and 1 blue. Human Advisor, legendary creature. White spells you control cost 1 less. Blue spells you control cost 1 less. And all your opponent's spells cost 1 more to play. This is the staple card of a blue-white deck in my mind. Because this card, it's 4 mana is nothing, is hardly anything really in the long run. It's fairly easy to play, especially if you're able to run multiple copies. Again, Mirror Gallery, anyone? You got Mirror Gallery. Oh man, Mirror Gallery, and have like 4 of these guys on the field. So all your blue and white spells cost 4 less to play, and all their spells cost 4 more to play. If they can destroy your Mirror Gallery, though, you're down to 1. Sad but true. But then again, you're probably only ever running 1 or 2 copies of this anyway. You never run 4 copies of a legendary creature just because there's no way for you to really utilize that effectively. Again, Mirror Gallery shenanigans notwithstanding. But this card is nothing but pure advantage and disadvantage in the best ways. It hinders your opponent in the best ways, because let's say they need to get that one card out and they're about to draw that one land that's going to bring out that super bomb card. You play this, like, nope, you need 1 more turn. All the while, I still got 3 mana to play. Let's say, yeah, it's turn 7, so you got 7 mana. I still got 3 mana to play with. And oh, look, I got 2 creatures that now cost 1 less each. I'm going to bring them both out. Then next turn, I'm going to start doing shenanigans and play a bunch of other stuff because it's all cheapened and your stuff is more expensive. How about that? Oh, you want to counter me? You're going to have to play 1 more to counter me. That just You'd never underestimate the ability to make your opponent's stuff cost extra, because it messes up their entire game plan then. And it's the true staple of being a blue-white dick. It really is. Oh, I love playing this card to death. Anytime I get it out, I'm like, okay, let's get some shit started right now. And then it dies. It does make it a very pretty big target at that as well, because it hinders a lot. If you can get this guy any form of protection, that like a hexproof, then yeah, you're fine then. Or if you can give him indestructible, or you can just pump him up, then he's perfect. But yeah, that's my top 10 Azorius blue-white cards. Thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed. Like, comment, share, subscribe. Ideas for who to wins, what is, put in the comments below. I'll be back with Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Him later tonight. So thanks for watching. See you next time.